سيدنا سيدنا محمد رسول الله ورب هذه الدعوة التامة والصلاة القائمة آتي سيدنا محمد الوسيلة والفضيلة والدرجة الرفيعة تبعث اللهم المقام المحمود الذي وعدته إنك لا تخلف الميعاد. اللهم آمين اللهم آمين اللهم آمين. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين ومن سار على دربه واقتفى أثره ليوم الدين. بسم الله وعلى بركة الله. Let's continue إن شاء الله reading from Shama'il with the hope إن شاء الله to finish it with the hope إن شاء الله that with every hadith we connect to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, with every hadith we know about the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم increases our love to him and increases our devotion and our commitment to elevate his sunnah and to live his model. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allahumma amin. Allahumma amin. Babu ma ja'a fi libasi Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Chapter on his clothing.
An Ummi Salamah radiyallahu ta'ala anha qalat kana ahabbu thiyabi ila Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam al-qamis.
Umm Salama radiallahu anha.
Umm Salama is the mother of the believers, right? One of the ladies that the Prophet married. She's from Banu Makhzum. What's her name? So we know her name. We know her nickname. Her nickname is Umm Salama, right? Because she had a son called Salama, right? But what's her name? Huh? Right? Somebody doesn't know the name of his mother, right? Her name is Zainab, her name is Hind. Hind bint Umayyah al-Makhzumiyyah. Hind, daughter of Umayyah. Right? The Prophet ﷺ married her the fourth year after the migration, after the death of her husband, Abu Salama. Her husband was one of the people that Halima al-Sa'diyah had nursed too. Kana أخو رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من الرضاع. He was one of the greatest men. And the hadith goes that the Prophet, when Sayyidina Abu Salama passed away, when Abu Salama passed away, she was very sad. She has little children, and she was very sad. Abu Salama was so great to her, very very great man. He was a great man. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came to her, and you know, to give her. To pay his condolences to her, and he said, you know, sbiri, and you know, be patient and ask Allah Ta'ala to give you the best. She said, oh, Apostle of Allah, there is no better than Abu Salama. You know, there is no better than Abu Salama. Abu Salama was a great man. And then afterwards, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked for her hand because she has a lot of children and she needed help. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked her if she wanted to marry him, and she said, oh, Apostle of Allah, I am jealous. And I have a lot of children and I would not give you your rights. She said, don't worry about your children, we'll take care of them together. And your jealousy, we'll ask Allah Ta'ala to take it away from you. And she was a blessing on the believers. Umm Salama was the wisest woman among the mothers of the believers. Very wise, really, really wise. We know what happened in Hudaybiyah. It was the opinion of Sayyidatuna Umm Salama that served the Ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and really helped the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam figure out a very difficult moment in the history of Islam. A very difficult moment. The Sahaba were recalcitrant and didn't want to obey the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was upset. He was really upset, and he went to her and he said, they are destroyed, they are destroyed, that's it, they are destroyed. And he said, Apostle of Allah, don't want it, but just go out, shave, and ask for your barber. Let him shave you and you will be fine. You will be fine. And that's what he did. He did exactly what she told him. He went out, called for the barber, he shaved his head, and that's it. And then the Sahaba felt so bad and they start fighting for his hair, and it's like nothing happened. And all of that due to what? Due to the wise opinion of Sayyidah Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha. If you read the advice of Umm Salama to Sayyida Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha after coming back from Al-Jamal, after the battle of the camel, you'll know how much this lady was was an amazing lady, radiallahu ta'ala anha. She died right after the death of Sidna al-Husayn, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. She, you know, people brought the news of Sidna al-Husayn to her and the way he was killed, and she was saddened. She was distraught. She was completely distraught. She was crying and crying and crying. She was saddened for the way Sidna al-Husayn died until she passed away. And she passed away. فحزنت عليه. Imam Dhabi says, فحزنت عليه حزنا شديدا فماتت من كثرة الحزن. فماتت من كثرة الحزن. She passed away out of her sadness of what happened to Sidna al-Husayn. رضي الله تعالى عنها. And she did not. She passed away right after his passing. رضي الله تعالى عنها. So what did she say, Umm Salama?
The apparel dearest to Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam was the long shirt.
Was the long shirt because it covers. The long shirt, qamis, used to go down and it covers and it's comfortable. عن أم سلمة قالت كان أحب الثياب إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم القميص. The same hadith from another isnad. عن أم سلمة رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت كان أحب الثياب إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لبس القميص. Same hadith again. عن شهر بن حوشب عن أسماء بنت يزيد رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت كان كم قميص رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى الرسغ.
أسماء بنت يزيد
was the خطيبة النساء. They used to call her خطيبة النساء. She used to be a very, very eloquent. She became Muslima at the first year of the Hijra. And she used to be, she gave the allegiance to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And she used to be very up front asking the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about every single thing, right? They say that, you know, remember that, say that Ansar, the Nisa al-Ansar, were very up front. They were strong ladies, and they used to go and ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about every single thing. They were not, you know, they wouldn't be shy, right? And she fought with the Sahaba in the Yarmouk, and she, you know, and so on and so forth. Not in Yarmouk. She fought with the Sahaba in Yarmouk, and she attended Khaybar, and also she attended the allegiance of the tree, Bay'at al-Ridwan. Naam?
The sleeve of the shirt of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam extended to the wrist.
To the wrist. عن معاوية بن قرة عن أبيه قال أتيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من مزينة لنبايعه وإن قميصه لمطلق أو قال زر قميصه لمطلق مطلق قال فأدخلت يدي في جيب قميصه فمسست الخاتم.
قراء بن إلياس رضي الله عنه, the father of معاوية بن قراء, said I came to Allah's Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم in a group of fewer than 10 men from the مزينة tribe. So that we might give him allegiance. Mm-hmm. And his shirt was unbuttoned at the top.
So unbuttoned in here. So look at this, what this man is going to do. Just imagine the audacity of this man, right? So go ahead. So what did he do?
So I inserted my hand in the opening of his shirt and I touched the seal.
He went out in the opening in here, and he went out and put his hand down to the shoulder of the Prophet, and he touched the seal of Prophet between his shoulders. And he did not say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam rebuked him and was angry on him. This is how easy the Prophet was. This is how easy the Prophet was, and this is how approachable the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. And I say it again and again and again, and I hope that people would listen to this. Listen, teaching books and teaching classes and doing all of that will not change the ummah. Will not. Look, we have tons of people who are great scholars in our ummah, and the ummah is still mutakhallifa, still bad, very backward, in a very bad state. Unless our scholars are prophetic in this way, they mingle with the people, and they're approachable with the people, and they start changing propensities and ways of thinking and ways of doing things, and so on and so, and they're beloved, then we can change the ummah. If you are just sitting in your university or sitting in a halaqah and waiting for the great people, great, good students to come to you, and they are serious and they are not, and they're good, nothing is going to change. We need this. Like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was approachable, easy to deal with. It was not somebody, you know, really, really mingling with the Sahaba. And they were so, you know, the proximity was there. He was with the Prophet. They never felt that they're strange from here, that there is no barrier, even with the prophethood. There wasn't barriers, right? They're going. No, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was easy going, especially for those who are far away. They come far away from Islam, from shirk or from al-kitab or so and so. So when I get people who are scholars or people who are studied abroad and they say, okay, you know, and we tell them, like, go and mingle with the scholars, go and mingle with the community. They say, look, no, we just want to teach classes. You're betraying the sunnah, you're betraying the heritage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's what you're doing. You just want to stay your... I remember once one of our shuyukh was asked about a great man in Casablanca, right? Very great man, great khatib and great alim, right? And he said, like, what do you think of that man? And he said, his garment is so clean. So people understood this to be, you know, a madh, a praise. Like the man has a great heart and clean heart and, you know, and so and so and so. And I didn't understood it to be so. And I said, like, no, you know. And then he explained it. He explained that this is not what he meant. You know, he meant that the man is completely, he never gone into the trenches of the da'wah, the trenches, when you all your that white garment is going to be dirtened and it's going to be touched by this and touched by that. You know, that's what the da'wah necessitates. It does not necessitate people at the top giving you, you know, class of fiqh, class of hadith, and it's well done and it's well clean. And it, you know, and that's it, and it stays there with serious students. But the ummah is still in its ignorance, and the ummah is still in its far away from the deen. We need to get to people, not to wait for people to come to us. To get to them. Right? To get to them. Struggling with a man. I was struggling with a man to get him to teach in an Islamic school because he said, I can't teach because I really, you know, I can only teach people who are serious. Those are kids who are going to have disciplinary issues. Like, you're not a man of da'wah. No matter how you studied, you're not a man of da'wah. You know, if you're not successful with the children, you're not going to be successful with others. Give your dues, pay your dues, and sit down in there and learn and have an impact on those young souls. And so that's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, easy going, easy, easy, approachable. And everybody is an opportunity for da'wah. Every person is an opportunity of da'wah, everyone. We don't choose and pick from the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? That's a long tangent, right? But I had to say that. عن أنس بن مالك قال إن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خرج وهو يتكئ على أسامة بن زيد عليه ثوب قطري قد توشح به فصلى بهم. أنس بن مالك.
أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه said the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came out leaning on أسامة بن زيد wearing a garment of cloth made in قطر which he had thrown on loosely.
A cloth, a piece of cloth that is qatari is a cloth that came from, it's not from Qatar, they say Qatari. No, it's not Qatari from Qatar. No, it's qatari from Yemen. It's a place from Yemen that just produce beautiful cotton or beautiful cloth, beautiful wool cloth and so. And they used to send it, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to wear it, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. عن أبي سعيد الخدري قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا استجد ثوبا سماه باسمه عمامة أو قميصا أو رداء ثم يقول اللهم لك الحمد كما كسوتنيه أسألك خيره وخير ما صنع له وأعوذ بك من شره وشر ما صنع له.
Abd ibn Humaid said Muhammad ibn al-Fadl said Yahya ibn Main asked me about this tradition the first time he sat with me, so I said Hamad ibn Salama related it to us.
Keep on going.
He said, if only it were in your book. I therefore got up to fetch my book, so he grasped my garment, then said, dictate it to me, for I am afraid that I shall not meet with you again. I therefore dictated it to him, and then I brought out my book and read to him.
This is, all right, so you got the gist of this or not? You got the gist of this? That when the narrator was sitting with his sheikh, and his sheikh told him, you know, and he said, can you narrate this hadith to me? And he said, sure, I'll narrate it to you. He said, why don't you narrate to me from your book? I want to make sure that you have it from your book. You have written it from your sheikh so I can be sure, right? And then he said, sure, I'll go up and get it from my book. But he said, okay, just, you know, before you go, narrate it to me orally or verbally, and then go get your book. So he narrated to him verbally, and then he went to his book, and he found that it was as he was narrated. So what is the students doing in here? He said, I don't know. First is that he's going to make sure that the hadith is narrated to him because the this is how much they remember death. That the person could stand up, get the book, but at that time, he would pass away and he would miss the opportunity of narrating this hadith from him. That's one thing. The second thing is that he wanted to test his memory, right? He said, like, narrate the hadith to me and then go and tell me how it is in your book. So he wanted to test his memory, how his memory is, right? And that's how it was. They were so careful, and also as great as Hammad ibn Salama. Hammad is great a narrator and so, but they want to make sure that he memorizes hadith. It's not just he is going to narrate it from his book. Mm-hmm. Next one.
Abu Sa'id al-Qudri radiallahu anhu said, when Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam wore a new garment, He would call it by its name.
Whenever the Prophet ﷺ would wear a new one, and that was not all the time, it was very seldom, really seldom. It was not, the Prophet ﷺ was not always changing his clothes, you know, here and there, you know, buying new clothes. No, it happens once in a while. And sometimes it happens at a time, you know, it happens once in years, when the Prophet ﷺ would buy something new or would get something new, because whatever he gets, he gives it to the people. It's a hadith in Sahih Bukhari in which the Prophet ﷺ was given a gift of a hulla, a beautiful qamis that is very green and beautiful. And then he wore it and he went out, and it was so beautiful on him. And the Sahaba were so happy seeing him wearing his garment. And then one of the Sahaba stood up and said, "Oh, Prophet of Allah, give it to me as a gift. Gift it to me." And the Sahaba were about to bite that guy to kill him, like, you know that he was wearing worn out clothes for so long, and then the first time for many years now that the Prophet is wearing something new, you're going to take it away from him? And the Prophet ﷺ said, just stay here. He went out, changed it, and came back. While he was changing it, the Prophet ﷺ changing it, the man was rebuked by the Sahaba. And he cried and he said, I only want to have that with me when I die. I want to be wrapped in it when I die. So when the malak, when the angel asks me, who is your prophet, I would tell him Muhammad, and this is his cloak. I would tell him Muhammad is my prophet and this is his cloak. And actually, that was Sidna Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf. In the hadith they say a man said, right? Called Tafleen. You know, they say in the hadith you'll find that it's a man said to the Prophet, give me your cloak, right? But the actual Sahabi, his name is Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf, and he was rich. Right, so he did not need that cloak because he did not have. He needed it for devotional reasons. Uh-huh. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam treated the cloth as every single thing else, as a living thing, as something that worships Allah Ta'ala, as something that has barakah or does not, like anything else in the world. Right, so he would address the thawb. He would address it. Huh? Or he would make dua for Allah Ta'ala to make that thawb, to make that new cloth, piece of clothes or apparel, as to make it blessed, and to make it, you know, bring its goodness to the person, and so. And that's what he does, Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, with every single thing. He sees the moon and he talks to it. He sees the, you know, the mountain and he talks to it. He talks to it. Rabbi wa Rabbuk Allah, talking to Uhud. My Lord and your Lord is Allah. Uhud and yuhibbuna wa yuhibbu. Uhud loves us and we love Uhud. He looks at the moon and says, Rabbi, my Lord and your Lord is Allah. Right? When the wind comes in, he changes and he starts making dua, and so on and so forth. The Prophet ﷺ thinks like that, always changing clothes, bringing whatever. It's an opportunity to ask Allah, to thank Allah, and it's an opportunity to bless that thing, to bless and ask the blessing of that thing from Allah Ta'ala. Uh-huh.
Then he would say, O Allah, praise be to you. As you have clothed me with it, I beg you for its goodness and the goodness of what it has been made for.
Yeah.
And I take refuge with you from its evil and the evil of what it has been made for.
That's every time the Prophet gets something new. عن أنس بن مالك قال كان أحب الثياب إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الحبرة.
أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه said, the apparel dearest to Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the hibara.
Al-hibara is like a cloak that is made from Yemen, that is made in Yemen, and it's striped, right? It has stripes, right? That's hibara. عن أبي عن عون بن أبي جحيفة عن أبيه قال رأيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وعليه حلة حمراء كأني أنظر إلى بريق ساقيه. قال سفيان أراها حبرة.
عون بن أبي جحيفة said that his father said, I saw the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم wearing a red garb as if I were looking at the brightness of his legs. سفيان said, I wonder if it might have been a
حبرة. عن البراء بن عازب قال ما رأيت أحدا من الناس أحسن في حلة حمراء من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن كانت جمته لتضرب قريبا من منكبيه. It's the same hadith that's narrated before from Sayyidina al-Bara ibn Azim. He said that I've never seen anybody more handsome in wearing a red garment or a two-piece suit, if you like, more than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His hair was touching his shoulders, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. عن أبي رمثة قال رأيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وعليه بردان أخضران. Abu Rimtha said that I've seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he was wearing two cloaks that are green. عن قيلة بنت مخرمة قالت رأيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وعليه أسمال مليتين كانتا بزعفران وقد نفضته. في الحديث قصة.
قيلة بنت مخرمة رضي الله عنها said, I saw the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم wearing worn out pieces of two sheets touched by saffron and they had dusted it off.
So the traces of saffron are still there, all right? They're still there. عن ابن عباس قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عليكم بالبياض من الثياب ليلبسها أحياؤكم وكفنوا فيها موتاكم فإنها من خيار ثيابكم.
Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه said, Allah's Messenger said صلى الله عليه وسلم, you must attend to the whiteness of clothes. Let your living ones wear them and your deceased be shrouded in them, for they are among the best of your clothes.
عن سمرة بن جندب قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم البسوا البياض فإن أطهر وأطيب وكفنوا فيها موتاكم. سمرة بن جندب said that, you know, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, wear that which is white because it's pure and it's pleasant and wrap your dead people or your dead in it. عن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت خرج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات غداة وعليه مرط من شعر أسود.
عائشة رضي الله عنها said Allah's Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم went out one early morning wearing a gown of black hair.
Black hair, hair of camels, camel hides or sheep, and if it was camel. No, if it was sheep, it would be suf, right? But this is sha'r, so it is camel, right? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I don't know if you've ever worn that, if you've ever seen it, they make cloaks in Morocco, especially in the southern side of Morocco. They make cloak of the hides of the camels, and it's really tough and rough, really tough. So if you wear it and it touches your neck like that, it's really going to mark your neck, no doubt about it, right? So that's how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out wearing. عن مغيرة بن شعبة عن أبيه عن عروة بن المغيرة بن شعبة عن أبيه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لبس جبة رمية ضيقة الكمين.
عروة بن المغيرة بن شعبة said that his father said the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم wore a Byzantine gown with narrow sleeves.
A Syrian gown. So at that time, he used to travel to Syria, and he used to bring clothes from them. So he wore that. It was not something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would reject. It was good. It was nice, and he wore it. Was not something that is made in Arabia. It was made in Byzantine, and this was to be the culture of the Byzantine people to wear it. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wore it in Tabuk رضي الله تعالى عنه. باب ما جاء في عيش رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Is that what it is? What's after that?
Chapter on his footgear.
باب ما جاء في خف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. عن ابن أبي بريرة عن أبيه أن النجاشي أهدى للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خفين أسودين ساذجين فلبسهما ثم توضأ ومسح عليهما.
بريدة رضي الله عنه said the emperor of Ethiopia gave the prophet صلى الله عليه
وسلم. النجاشي he was the man that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent the Sahaba to him because he was just, and there is a that he, you know, there are a lot of ahadith that he believed in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he passed away as a Muslim. Actually, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made du'a for him when he was challenged by one of his nephews. He wanted to depose him, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew about that, and he made du'a for him. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw him in his dream. And the Prophet ﷺ prayed on him when he passed away. You know, it arrived to him, Sayyidina Jibreel mentioned it to him, and he said that he passed away, and the Prophet ﷺ prayed on him. So it was one of the people who, you know, who seen the Prophet ﷺ, who did not see the Prophet ﷺ and believed in him in a very strong way, right?
Gave the Prophet ﷺ a pair of plain black leather socks, so he put them on, then performed the wudu and wiped over them.
And the Prophet ﷺ did not ask if they were the sheep from which, or the animal from which that hide of the, or that skin came out of, was sacrificed in proper way or not. That's one thing. The second thing is that Najashi also gave the dowry of the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married while she was in Abyssinia. Who is she? Ummu Habiba. What's her name? Come on, guys. Ladies, what's her name? Ummu Habiba. Ummu Habiba bint Abi Sufyan. Ramla. Her name is Ramla. Ramla bint Abi Sufyan. Her nickname was Ummu Habiba. The one who paid the dowry for that marriage, for the marriage, is al-Najashi, who is the one who paid that dowry for Ummu Habiba. So this is al-Najashi. قال المغيرة بن شعبة أهدى دحية للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خفين فلبسهما. قال إسرائيل عن جابر عن عامر وجبة فلبسهما حتى تخرق لا يدري النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أذكي هما.
المغيرة بن شعبة رضي الله عنه said, Dithya, a notable companion of his, gave the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم a pair of plain black shoes, so he wore them.
صلى الله عليه وسلم.
And Israel said, on the authority of Jabir, on the authority of Amir, he also gave him a gown, so he wore the shoes until they were perforated, without the Prophet ﷺ knowing whether or not they were made from the hide of a lawfully slaughtered animal.
That tells you that the hadith in here is mentioned probably as an answer to somebody who asks, can we get the khuf or the leather socks off the people of the book, or the people that, because they traveled, the Sahaba traveled and they conquered other places and so on and so. And they had those leather socks sold and stuff like that. So could we use them? And the hadith came in like the Prophet ﷺ he wore those without knowing if they were properly slaughtered or not. باب ما جاء في نعل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Chapter on his sandals.
عن قتادة قلت لأنس بن مالك رضي الله تعالى عنه كيف كان نعل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ قال لهما قبالان.
Qatada radiallahu anhu said, I asked Anas ibn Malik, how were the sandals of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said they had two laces.
You all seen the sandal of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? Yes, right? We should have. You've seen Celebrate Mercy stuff, right? The sandal of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has a great history. The sandal of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how it was celebrated, the great history of celebration of the sandal of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Tons of poetry had been written about it. Tons of poetry had been written about the sandal of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there are certain houses that inherited the sandal of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from that time until now, right? So there is a sandal of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that has been in the Umayyad mosque for a very long time, and I think it was taken by the Ottoman empire later on, but it was displayed in a box of glasses in the Umayyad mosque in Damascus for a very long time. In the 7th century or 6th century, it was an Andalusian traveler who was passing by, coming from Hajj, went to Damascus and he prayed in there. And the night of the Mawlid, they opened that thing, and it was seen by everybody, and he looked at it and he copied that, just a copy. He copied the example of that sandal of the Prophet ﷺ displayed in there in a piece of leather. And he took it with him to Syria. He took it with him to Andalus. And the whole life of that you know, example that he had drawn emerged. Tons of books about it. You know, I mean, hundreds, if not thousands, of verses of poetry about the descent of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. People celebrated it because it reminds them of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you look at the book called "And Muhammad and His Messenger" by Anne Mary Schimmel, she has a chapter on that and with the pictures and how it was celebrated. Just the sandal was celebrated from Andalus and Maghrib until India, how they celebrated that example and so on. So, yeah. So the sandal of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had two laces. And the hadith عن ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنه وكان أن نعي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قبالان مثنن شراكهما, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had a sandal, has two laces, but they were doubled. They were doubled. And عيسى بن طهمان قال خرج إلينا أنس بن مالك نعلين جرداوين لهما قبالان, فقال حدثني ثابت بعد عن أنس أنهما كانتا نعلي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, نعلي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. That Isa ibn Tahman said that Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu brought to us two sandals of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they were plain, and they had two laces. And he said Thabit afterwards that Sidna Anas told them that this is the sandals of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. An Ubayd ibn Jarir al-Nuqal ibn Umar ra'aytuka talbasu an-ni'al as-sibtiyata قال إني رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يلبس النعال التي ليس فيها شعر ويتوضأ فيها, فأنا أحب أن ألبسها.
عبيد ابن جريج رضي الله عنه said to ابن عمر رضي الله عنه, I saw you wearing the tanned oxhide sandals with no hair on them. He replied, I saw Allah's Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم wearing the sandals on which there is no hair.
I saw the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم wearing the sandals in which there is no hair. They were following the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in things that are mundane, that appears to us trivial, right? So even the sandals, he wants to follow the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in it. But this is Sidna Abdullah ibn Umar. He was the man who actually looked for every sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Everything that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did was of value to him, whether he understood what it is or he did not. He was asked one day when he would turn, was going to Hajj or Umrah, and he turned around a tree in the way. He just turned around that tree and he continued. And they said, why did you turn around that tree? And he continued. He said, I saw the Prophet doing it once. That was enough for him. Right? That was enough for him. So what is the motive driving Sidna Abdullah ibn Umar to do that? It's the love. It is the love. It's not the turn. That turn doesn't make anything. Right? Yeah, it doesn't make anything. It doesn't mean anything to him. What means to him is the person who had done that. Right? Allahu ta'ala anhu. عن أبي هريرة قال كان لنعل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قبالان. سيدنا أبو هريرة said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم sandal, he has to have two laces. عن عمرو بن حريث يقول رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي فينا علينا مخصوفتين. This man said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, that I've seen the Prophet, عمرو بن حريث said, I've seen the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم praying in two sandals that are patched, which means that there is holes in them, and the Prophet and he gave it to somebody and he patched it for him. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. عن أبي هريرة أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا يمشين أحدكم في نعل واحدة لينعلهما أو ليحفهما جميعا.
On the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, let none of you walk in a single sandal.
Yeah, if it's because you have laces, if these laces are cut off because or whatever, you know, people used to, you know, what are they going to do? One has the laces attached to your foot and the other one does not, and it's unwearable. So what do? People take the one that is unwearable in their hand and they walk in one foot that is barefoot and the other one with the sandal. The Prophet said, if that happened to you, put them both, wear them both together, or stay barefoot in both of the feet. Take them both together off. Sayyidina Aisha didn't like this hadith. He said, Abu Hurairah did not understand this hadith. See, one of the hadith that Sayyidina Aisha had criticized of Abu Hurairah. She criticized many hadith, right? One of them is this one. She said, Abu Hurairah didn't get this hadith. If it was only the opinion of Abu Hurairah, it was only the narration of Abu Hurairah and the narration of Sayyidina Aisha, we would take Sayyidina Aisha. Why? Why would we take the narration of Sayyidina Aisha over Abu Huraira? More? That's that? She was faqiha. She was a faqiha. She was a jurist. Right? She was way more knowledgeable in the jurisprudence than Abu Huraira. Abu Huraira was a narrator. He narrates a lot, he memorizes a lot. In the understanding of the deen and the application of the deen, Sayyidina Aisha was much better, no doubt. Right? No doubt. So, but this hadith in here did not come to us only from Abu Huraira, it came to us from other ways. Sayyidina Jabir narrated this hadith. And many and two or three other sahaba narrated the same hadith. Right? So Sayyidina Aisha did not accept this hadith from Abu Huraira. And she used to, sometimes when it happens to her, she would walk in one and keep the one in her hand, and she said, like, I'm making Abu Huraira upset. Right? Just for the sake of making Abu Huraira upset. Right? But the reality is the hadith came to us through other sahabas, and that's why we're going to go with the narration of Abu Huraira, because it is corroborated by other sahaba, right? أن النبي عن جابر بن عبد here we go عن أبي الزبير عن جابر أن النبي صلى الله عليه وصحبه وسلم نهى أن يأكل يعني الرجل بشماله أو يمشي في نعل واحدة.
On the authority of Jabir رضي الله عنه, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم forbade one to eat with his or her left hand or to walk in a single sandal.
People sometimes don't realize. You know, eating with your left, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that. He said, like shaitan eats with you. So eat with your right. So, you know, subhanAllah, met with some brothers. They are nice brothers. Very nice brothers. And they refused to eat with your rights. They said, I don't believe in that. It's like, what do you mean you don't believe in that? Like, what do you mean? Like, no, that, you know, eating with right and left doesn't make any sense. You know, it's not. I'm telling you, the Prophet ﷺ said in the Hadith Sahih, you cannot reject that. Right? So if you love him, even if there is no ramifications about the shaitan or anything, if you love him, you would do it. Just do it. Right? Follow his sunnah. We said, Adatul Ashrafi, Ashraful Adat. Ashraful Adat. An Abi Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala. These are educated people, right? PhD students and so smart. عن أبي هريرة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا انتعل أحدكم فليبدأ باليمين وإذا نزع فليبدأ بالشمال فلتكن اليمنى أولهما تنعل وآخرهما تنزع.
أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه said, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, when one of you puts on sandals, let him or her begin with the right, and when he or she takes them off, let him or her begin with the left, for the right must be the first of them to be put on and the last of them to be taken off.
That is a barakah in the sunnah of the Prophet. Imagine if you follow the details of the sunnah in those small, quote-unquote, small things. Imagine. Your life will be modeled on the life of the Prophet. You remember the Prophet all the time. You remember. Your habits becomes his habits. Your customs become his customs. And how great is that? Right? You're not driven by your hawa. You're not driven by just like whatever. No, there is purposefulness in what you do, as small as that. If you pay attention, this is what the sunnah does. What the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ does is that it focuses your attention to the details, to the small things. If you're alert doing the small things, then how is it going to be when you're faced with the big things? You'll be more alert, right? Right? So if we ask always, what is the cure for ghafla? What is the cure for ghafla? What is the cure for carelessness, forgetfulness? It is following the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ in its details. And then you'd wake up. Because as we said, and remember this, every sunnah is a light. Every sunnah is a light. A lack of sunnah is darkness. Right? Every sunnah is a light. A lack of a sunnah is darkness. Right? عن عائشة قالت كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يحب التيامن ما استطاع تيمن ما استطاع في ترجله وتنعله وطهوره, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to love using right in every single thing as much as he can. When he comb his hair, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he wears his shoes, and when he starts his wudu or ghusl. عن أبي هريرة قال كان لنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قبالان وأبي بكر وعمر رضي الله تعالى عنهما وأول من عقد عقدا واحدا عثمان رضي الله تعالى عنه. Abu Huraira said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sandal used to have two laces, and Abu Bakr same wise, and Umar same wise, and the first one to have one lace is Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Again, the culture is changing. the culture and the habits and things are changing, because now we have other nations bringing their own, you know, their own habits and their own ways of doing things that will start mingling with the Arabic culture. باب ما جاء في ذكر خاتم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Chapter on his ring.
Chapter on the ring of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. عن ابن شهاب عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله تعالى عنه قال كان خاتم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من ورق وكان فصه حبشيا. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم's ring was from silver, and the gem of it was made in Abyssinia, or they say it was حبشيا. Here means has two meanings. Whether it was black, the gem was black, or it was from Abyssinia, right? Was from Abyssinia. That's the difference, right? حدثنا قتيبة قال حدثنا أبو عوانة عن أبي بشر عن نافع عن ابن عمر أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اتخذ خاتما من فضة فكان يختم به ولا يلبسه.
Ibn Umar رضي الله عنه said the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم chose a signet ring of silver.
So as a signet ring, which means he used to sign with it. We're going to see why the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had taken that thing to sign with. You know, we you see it right now all over, right? And sadly in those flags of those criminals, misguided, ISIS and others, they put La ilaha illallah, they put Allah and Muhammad, the Allah Rasul and Muhammad, right? That's the signet of the Prophet. The Prophet ring that used to sign the books with used to have Allah at the top, Rasul at the middle, and then Muhammad. So you read it from the bottom, Muhammadun Rasulullah, right? So Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar said that he used to sign with it, but he was not wearing it. But we have other ahadith in which the Prophet ﷺ used to wear it. Or they had multiple one. He has one that he used to sign with, was not wearing it much, and then he used to have another one that he used to wear time to time, not all the time. عن أنس بن مالك قال كان خاتم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من فضة فصه منه.
Anas ibn Malik رضي الله عنه said the signet ring of the Prophet ﷺ consisted of silver, including its stone.
Its stone is from it, like its stone is part of it. لما عن أنس بن مالك قال لما أراد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يكتب إلى العجم قيل له إن العجم لا يقبلون كتابا إلا عليه إلا لا يقبلون إلا كتابا عليه خاتم فاصطنع خاتما فكأني أنظر إلى بياضه في كفه صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Anas ibn Malik رضي الله عنه said when Allah's messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم wished to write to the non-Arabs, he was told the non-Arabs will not accept a letter unless it bears a seal. He therefore created a signet, and I feel like I am seeing its whiteness in the palm of his hand.
He used to wear it, but he used to put the gem or the signet inside his palm. It was not outside. He used to wear it inside. You understand what I'm talking about? You know what I'm talking about? He's not wearing it. He's wearing the gem inside his hand, right in here, on his palm. It was not at the top in here. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. عن أنس بن مالك قال كان نقش خاتم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم محمد سطر ورسول سطر والله سطر. That the engraving of on the signet of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to be Muhammad in one line, Rasul in one line, and Allah in one line. And you start from the bottom, you read it from the bottom. So Allah's name is at the top, and Rasul is at the middle, and then Muhammad is at the bottom. عن أنس بن مالك قال أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كتب إلى كسرى وقيصر والنجاشي فقيل له إنهم لا يقبلون كتابا إلا بخاتم فساغ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خاتما حلقته فضة ونقش فيه محمد رسول الله وحلقته.
Anas ibn Malik رضي الله عنه said the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم wrote to Kisra, Caesar and Najashi, so he was told the non-Arabs will not accept a letter unless it bears a seal. Allah's messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم therefore created a signet which had a silver ring and on which was engraved Muhammad is the messenger of Allah.
عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله تعالى عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا دخل الخلاء نزع خاتمه. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, whenever he went to the bathroom, he would take out his ring. Why? Because it has the name of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. That means that he used to wear it, right? That means that he used to wear it. And سيدنا أنس would know better in this matter than سيدنا عبد الله بن عمر, right? عن ابن عمر قال كاتخذ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خاتما من ورق فكان في يده ثم كان في يد أبي بكر ويد عمر ثم كان في يد عثمان حتى وقع في بئر أريس نقشه محمد رسول الله.
Ibn Umar رضي الله عنه said Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose a signet ring of silver. So it was in his hand, then it went to Abu Bakr, then to Umar, then to Uthman, until it fell into the well of Hadith.
It was in the hand of Sidna Abu Bakr after him, it was in the hand of Sidna Umar after him, until the time of Sidna Uthman. Sidna Uthman used to go to the places in which he used to meet with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr and Umar with, and Sidna Ali with. And the place, there is one place in Medina in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go to and meet with his friends, close friends, very close friends, and talk to them and hang out with them. This place used to be called Bi'r Aris. It has beautiful water, one of the eight wells in Medina. Medina has eight wells at that time. One of the eight wells that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go to was Bi'r Aris, right? And he used to go and dingle his feet under it and talk to the Sahaba and so on, hang out with them. Sidna Uthman used to go there and remember and reminisce about those days. So one day he went there with his servant, right? His servant is Mu'ayqib. The Prophet, Sidna Uthman, that was in the sixth year of the caliphate of Sidna Uthman. The sixth year of his caliphate. He gave it to him. And it dropped out, and he gave it to Sidna Uthman, took it away, probably making wudu or something. He gave it to his servant Mu'ayqib, and it dropped into the well. It dropped into the well. Sidna Uthman was stunned. He said, call whoever you want to help you get this ring. This is the ring of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no way I'm leaving this place without it. There is no way I'm leaving this place without it. They looked, they went down, they completely cleaned out that well, and it wasn't there. It wasn't there. It was sad. Sidna Uthman was very sad losing that ring. And a lot of people put a lot of symbolism on losing the ring of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on what's going to happen to Sidna Uthman and so on. So, Bab Umar, please feel free if there is any addition that you want to add. Don't hesitate, or question or comments. Please don't hesitate. Bab Umar jaa fi takhattum Rasulillahi sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Chapter on his wearing a ring.
How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to wear his ring. Where? And how, right? عن علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله تعالى عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يلبس خاتمه في يمينه. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, سيدنا علي said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to wear his ring in his right hand. عن عبد الله بن جعفر قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يتختم في يمينه. نعم.
Allah ibn Ja'far said Allah's Messenger.
Allah ibn Ja'far is one of the first born to the people in Abyssinia. When his dad was in Abyssinia, his mom was in Abyssinia, right? When they went there, he was the first born in there. His name is Abdullah ibn Ja'far. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to love him, used to kiss him after the death of his dad, right? His dad passed in Mu'ta, right? He passed away in Mu'ta. When did he come back from Abyssinia?
Second
year of Hijrah? Allah Yawdi.
When they were going to the Ghazwa.
No, Fatah Khaybar. More than that. Fatah Khaybar. When did Khaybar happen? Khaybar happened in the 7th year of Hijrah. Way more than that. Right. So, Khaybar. Fatah Khaybar. Sidna Ja'far. Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. La adri bi ayyihima usar. Bi fathi Khaybar am bi qudumi Ja'far. I don't know which one is more that I should be happy with. The opening of Khaybar or the coming of Ja'far. And the Prophet kissed him in his cheek. He kissed him in his cheek, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Loved him so much, right?
Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, used to wear a signet ring on his right hand.
And Abdullah ibn Ja'far, annahu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kana yatakhattamu fi yameenihi, nafs, the same hadith, but with different isnad. And Jabir ibn Abdullah, anna nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kana yatakhattamu fi yameenihi, the same hadith, but from Sidna Jabir ibn Abdullah this time. عن كان ابن عباس يتختم في يمينه ولا إخاله إلا قال كان رسول الله يتختم في يمينه. Now Abdullah ibn Abbas used to wear his ring in his right, and he said, and I thought, the narrator said, I thought he said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do so. عن ابن عمر أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اتخذ خاتما من فضة وجعل فصه مما يلي كفه ونقش فيه محمد رسول الله ونهى أن ينقش أحد عليه وهو الذي سقط من معيقب في بئر أريس. Now we talked about this. Sidna Abdullah ibn Abbas said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took a signet from silver, a ring from silver, and then the gem was from, and he used to put the gem from in the side inside of his palm, right? and it was engraved in it Muhammadun Rasulullah, and he prohibited anybody to touch it, to engrave anything other than that in it. And that was the ring that was that fell from Mu'aqib in the well of Aris. Mu'aqib is the servant of Sidna Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. عن جعفر بن محمد عن أبيه قال كان الحسن والحسين يتختمان في يسارهما. That Sidna Hassan and Hussein used to wear their rings in the left. And again, there are narrations. The majority of the narrations is that the Prophet ﷺ used to wear it in his right, but Al Bayt usually they wear it in their left. So Sidna Hassan and Sidna Hussein. Even Sidna Ali used to wear it in his right. And I wouldn't think that they would do that. There is no narration or something that they inherited from their forefathers teaching them that. عن أنس بن مالك قال أنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يتختم في يمينه. That رسول الله used to wear, the majority of the time he used to wear it in his right. عن ابن عمر قال اتخذ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خاتم من ذهب فكان يلبسه في يمينه. اتخذ الناس خواتم من ذهب فطرحه صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال لا ألبسه أبدا. فطرح الناس خواتمهم. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abdullah ibn Umar narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had taken a ring from gold, and he used to wear it in his right. And then people start emulating the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and having rings of gold in their hands. And then one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam just, you know, give it away, and they throw it away. And they said, I will not wear it ever. I will not wear this ever out of gold. And then people also abandoned their rings. نعم باب ما جاء في صفة سيف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Chapter on his sword.
The sword of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. How was it? عن أنس قال كانت قبيعة سيف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من فضة.
Anas رضي الله عنه said the pommel of the sword of what Allah's is called? Messenger.
Pommel. You know what's the pommel? The pommel نعم the Danish. Exactly. So the handle. So you have the handle, but you have something that remains like a small ball in here or a small rounded thing at the bottom of your sword. That is called the pommel. Exactly. That is exactly what it is. That's called the pommel, in English. So when we teach the class in Celebrate Mercy, we show it. Like this is we show the thing so people can see what is the pommel. So that is the thing that comes out. You have the handle, but at the bottom of the handle there is that little round thing that prevents your hand from slipping, right? That's called qabi'a in Arabic. That piece from the sword of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to be made of silver. قال أخو الحسن قال سعيد بن أبي الحسن البصري وأخو الحسن البصري قال كانت قبيعة سيف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من فضة. Same حديث. عن هود هو ابن عبد الله بن سعيد عن جده قال دخل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يوم فتح مكة وعلى سيفه ذهب وفضة. قال طالب فسألته عن الفضة فقال كانت قبيعة السيف فضة.
On the authority of Hud that his grandfather said Allah's messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered Mecca on the day of victory with gold and silver on his sword. An inquirer said,
there is gold and silver in his sword. Imam al-Dhahabi said that this addition of gold is very anomalous. Very anomalous that the majority of the ahadith that we have, or all the ahadith that we have, are all mentioning silver, except this one is mentioning gold, right? Naam?
An inquirer said, so I asked him about the silver, and he said the pommel of the sword was silver.
Was silver, okay. صنعت سيفي عن ابن سيرين قال صنعت سيفي على سيف سمرة بن جندب وزعم سمرة أنه صنع سيفه على سيف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وكان حنيفيا.
ابن سيرين رضي الله عنه said I made my sword.
Ibn Sirin is one of the greatest men of the Tabi'in, was a student of Sidna Anas bin Malik and many other Sahaba. He was a Basri, he was from Basra radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he was, you know, the greatest interpreter of dreams, and he was a great narrator and a great, you know, righteous man in the history of Islam.
I made my sword in the shape of the sword of Samura.
I made my sword on the shape of the sword of Samura ibn Jundub, right? And Samura claims that he made his sword on the shape of the sword of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the sword of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to be Hanifi. Right? Hanifi, what does that mean? Made by Banu Hanifa. Banu Hanifa is a tribe of, was not, it doesn't mean that it was like, the sword of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam followed the madhab of Abu Hanifa. That's not that. No. It was that it was made by the tribe of Banu Hanifa, the tribe of Musaylim al-Kadhab. They used to, you know, that place of Musaylim al-Kadhab, Yamama and those areas, used to have it all. They used to have crops. This is the storehouse of Arabia and crops. And they used to be great makers of swords. Right? And that's why it was powerful. It was very, very difficult to eradicate after the passing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A lot of Sahaba died in fighting Musaylim al-Kadhab because he belonged to a tribe in which they have crops. They were the reservoir. They were the reserves. They had the reserves of all Arabia from the crops. And they had swords. Right? Banu Hanifa used to make great sword, great. نعم باب ما جاء في صفة درع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Chapter on his armor.
And boy, that sword of Samurah ibn Jundub worked hard, right? Killed a lot of people, right? Imam Dahabi said, "قتل سمرة بشرا كثيرا ونرجو له بصحبته لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم." هكذا قال الإمام الذهبي. باب ما جاء في صفة درع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. ها؟
Chapter on his armor.
عن الزبير بن عوام قال كان على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يوم أحد درعان. So the armor is the thing that, you know, it's like the armor are like the, what do you call those chain?
Chain mail.
It's called chain mail, right? The chain mail that you wear, right? So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had in أحد في أحد يوم أحد درعان فنهض إلى الصخرة فلم يستطع فأقعد طلحة تحته وصعد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى استوى على الصخرة قال سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول أوجب طلحة لا إله إلا الله.
الزبير ابن العوام.
زبير بن عوام is who? Come on guys, you should know this one. One of the 10 that are given the glad tidings of Jannah, right? He's the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, isn't he? Isn't he? Cousin from where? From what relationship? What type of relationship?
His mother's side?
No. His father's side. He is the son of who? He's the son of Safiya. Safiya is the aunt, the paternal aunt of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Safiya is the paternal aunt of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? He is her son. The Prophet said in the Hadith Sahih, "Bashir qatil ibn Safiyyah bin Nar." Let the one who kills son of Safiyyah, let him see his place in Jahannam. Ibn Safiyyah, the Prophet used to love him. He used to be called the disciple of the Prophet, Hawariyyu Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to be married to who? No. Asma' bint Abi Bakr. He used to be married to Sayyidina Asma' bint Abi Bakr. And he used to be the father of who? The first newborn in Medina. The first born in Medina to the Muhajirin was? Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Right. And so on. So, you know, he died after Al-Jamal. He died right after Al-Jamal. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. What did he say?
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wore two body armors of chainmail on the day of Uhud.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't want to go out in Uhud. He was forced to go out to Uhud. And then when he went out to Uhud, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wore his two chainmails. And it was they were really heavy, right? Because the Prophet was very strong. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not really weak and just like, no. He was really strong. His body was fit. The Prophet was strong. Right, so he wore two of them because he knew that things are going to happen. Mm-hmm.
So he tackled the rock but could not climb it.
They pushed him to a rock at the side of the Uhud. They pushed him to a rock. They pushed the mushrikeen. They were only three or four Sahaba with him. And they pushed him. And they, when they killed Musa ibn Umair, they thought that they killed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they start saying, we killed Muhammad, and we killed Muhammad, and the Sahaba start running away. And they didn't know where to go, because now the Prophet is killed, and what are we going to do, and so on and so. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants to let the Sahaba know that he was not killed. How is he going to do that? He has to make himself visible to them, and he was going to call on the Sahaba to come back, that he is not killed, right? So he was pushed to a rock, a huge rock, and then Sidna Talha used to fight for him, and he was fighting, and Sidna Talha and he's inside. So he told Talha to kneel, go on his hand and his knees like that, and then just like that, and then the Prophet ﷺ put his foot on his back, and he climbed on the rock. And he called for the Sahaba to come back. Now he's visible. The Sahaba saw him. He's not dead. And he saw him, and he came, and they came back. The Prophet ﷺ after that said, "Awjaba Talha," which means Talha had done today something that no matter what he had done, what he would do after that, Jannah is his place. That Talha ibn Ubaidillah had done something today that obligated Jannah for him. He's one of the 10 that are obligated, that are given the glad tidings of Jannah, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He died also right after Muqa'at al-Jamal. He was among the 6 or 7 people who became Muslim. Sidna Talha ibn Ubaidillah, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And then, عن الساء بن يزيد talks about the Sahabi later on. أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان عليه يوم أحد درعان قد ظاهر بينهما. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in Uhud had two chain mails or two armors that he doubled, he put them together, you know, both of them. باب ما جاء في صفة مغفر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Chapter on his helmet.
Chapter on the helmet of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We talked about his helmet also in Uhud. The helmet went deep into part of the helmet that he was wearing, went deep into his cheek. It was Sidna Talha who pulled it out. And because of that Sidna Talha lost his tooth. He lost his tooth because of that. He pulled that armor, pulled that piece of iron from, and with it his tooth came out. Right? And that's what Sidna Talha, that's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Awjaba Talha." Right? أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن أنس بن مالك أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم دخل مكة وعليه مغفر فقيل له هذا ابن خطل متعلق بأستار الكعبة فقال اقتلوه.
أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه said the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم entered Mecca wearing a helmet. He was told.
And when is that? فتح مكة. In فتح مكة, in the opening of Mecca, huh?
He was told, "This is Ibn Khattal."
Ibn Khattal was one of the people nobody was killed in the opening of Mecca. Only few people, only three people that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered to be killed. Actually, four. Two of them. One of them ran away and came back later on and became Muslim. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him security. The other two ran away, two ladies, and then one is Ibn Khattal. Ibn Khattal came in. He did not ask forgiveness from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He did not, you know, he was just hanging on the Kaaba. So what did Ibn Khattal do to deserve that? Like, a lot of people had been enemies of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, did a lot of things. But why did Ibn Khattal, this man, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered to be killed? Right, did a lot of things. First, he had two female slaves that he used to hire to defame the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with their songs and so on. And you know, that was the Fox News of that time. But it was not just that. This man, his specialty was to go and harm the Muslims. Right? So when Muslims migrated, there are a lot of people who stayed in Mecca who could not migrate. He would not go to the people who are strong and can defend themselves, to the men, would go to the ladies and harm them. He did not only stop there. He went even further. Sidna al-Abbas, how did Sayyidah Fatima and the daughters of the Prophet ﷺ migrated to him? How did they migrate back to him? Right? Especially those who were not married. Sidna al-Abbas took them. After the Prophet migrated, Sidna al-Abbas put them in camels and he drove them to Medina. In multiple times, right? Sidna al-Abbas is taking them out in the camel, and this man came in and pushed the daughters of the Prophet out of the camels. This is what Ibn Khattal did. Fatima and Umm Kulthum, just pushed them out of the camels. passing by, pushed them out of the camels multiple times. He did not just have an animosity to the Prophet ﷺ, but it was not just a personal thing. It was something that he went to the ladies of the Muslims. He defamed them and he was harming them. He was persecuting them and harming them. And the Prophet ﷺ had given the permission to kill this man. عن أنس بن مالك أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم دخل مكة عام الفتح وعلى رأسه المغفر فلما نزعه جاءه رجل فقال له إن ابن خطر متعلق بأستار الكعبة فقال اقتلوه. قال ابن شهاب وبلغني أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يكن محرما يومئذ محرما. The same hadith that we just read. باب ما جاء في عمامة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. عن حماد بن سلمة عن أبي الزبير عن جابر دخل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مكة يوم الفتح وعليه عمامة سوداء. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came into Mecca at the day of the opening of Mecca, and he had a imama, a turban that was black. That's why you see a lot of Shia wearing black. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to wear a black turban. عن جعفر بن عمرو بن حريث عن أبيه قال رأيت على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عمامة سوداء. This man had said that I've seen on the head of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم عمامة, turban that is black. Same hadith عن جعفر بن عمرو بن حريث عن أبيه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خطب الناس وعليه عمامة سوداء. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم gave a sermon and he had a turban that is black. عن نافع عن ابن عمر قال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا اعتم سدل عمامته بين كتفيه. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, ابن عمر said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم whenever he had a turban, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would extend the we call it in Arabic عذبة. You know, the extension on the parts that you put, and he would put it, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would put it behind his shoulders, right? Sometimes the Arabs used to cover their faces with it, right? That extension of the, you make the imamah, there is a piece of it like this or longer, that is the last extension of it, and they would cover their faces or their necks with it, right? But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to put it behind his back, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. عن كلمة عن ابن عباس أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خطب الناس وعليه عمامة دسماء. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had given a sermon and he had a imama that is black. Not only that, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم also had a imama that is yellow. He had a imama that is of a yellow color. باب ما جاء في صفة إزار رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Chapter on
his lower garment.
Chapter on his lungi. Right, just the lungi, the izar, right, the izar of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, which lower garment. عن أبي بردة عن أبي قال أخرجت لنا عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها كساء ملبدا وإزارا غليظا فقالت قبض روح رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في هذين.
On the authority of Abu Burda, his father said, Aisha رضي الله عنها brought out to us a tangled garment and a coarse loincloth.
Coarse. No, it was not tender. It was not soft, it was coarse. Uh-huh.
Then she said, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away in these two.
Nothing from the dunya. The dunya did not capture the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He left it all here. He left it all here. He disdained the dunya. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. عن الأشعث بن سليم قال سمعت عمتي تحدث عن عمها قال بين أنا أمشي في المدينة إذا إنسان خلفي يقول ارفع إزارك فإنه أتقى وأبقى فإذا هو رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم فقلت يا رسول الله إنما هي بردة ملحاء قال أما لك في أسوة فنظرت فإذا إزاره إلى نصف ساقيه.
Al-Ashab ibn Sulaym said, I heard my maternal aunt relate on the authority of her paternal uncle. While I was walking in Medina, there was a person behind me saying,
he was walking and he has his clothes dragging behind him. He has his izar, his lungi, right? His izar is dragging behind him, right? And then?
Raise your loincloth.
And then a man behind him telling him, like, raise it up. It shouldn't drag behind you. Uh-huh.
For that is more pious and conducive to longer wear. Lo and behold, he was Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I said, O Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is simply a longer garment.
It is a longer and it's very extended, it's very long. Uh-huh.
He said, do you not have an example in me? So I looked and noticed that his loincloth reached the middle of his shins.
Lowering the garment at that time to under the ankles was a sign of pride. That's how people would show their social status and that they are great and so and so, because you have enough garment, you have enough money to buy enough garment that go and drag behind you, right? And that was a sign of pride. Sidna Abu Bakr was a man who was not a big man, and his waist was not a big waist. So when he wears his izar, it drags behind him, not because he chooses to, right? Just because even if he ties it up, it goes down. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, "Oh, Apostle of Allah, am I among those?" He said, No, you're not among those. That means in here that it's the intention that is very essential in here. The intention and also the cultural, environment. You know, what makes pride right now is not that. There is a lot of signs of pride in this culture, not like the in Arabia in 14 centuries ago. There are a lot of other ways that people show their pride right now other than that we should pay attention to. So people pay attention to that, but they forget the other ways they show their pride and their and stuff. Right? عن سلمة بن الأكوع عن أبيه رضي الله تعالى عنه قال كان عثمان بن عفان يأتزر إلى أنصاف ساقيه وقال هكذا كانت إزرة صاحبي يعني النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. نعم.
On the authority of Iyas ibn Salama al-Aqwa, his father said, Uthman ibn Affan,
one of the great Sahaba, and so he attended Mu'tah, and he was from the people of Bay'at Ridwan. He gave the allegiance to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and Ridwan, and the hadith narrated that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was putting him behind, he was riding behind the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and then the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam made istighfar for him, and so on and so forth.
Uthman ibn Affan used to wear a loincloth reaching the middle parts of his shin. And he said, in this manner was the loincloth of my companion, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Which means the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. An Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman, and this will be the last hadith, inshallah. An Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman. قال أخذ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بعضلة ساقي أو ساقي فقال هذا موضع الإزار فإن أبيت فلا حق للإزار في الكعبين.
Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman radiallahu anhu.
Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman is one of the greatest Sahaba of Medina. His father was a Muslim. His father was killed in Uhud by mistake. Right? His father was killed in Uhud by mistake. They took him for a mushrik. Right? People are, and he was calling, "My dad, it's my dad, it's my dad," and he was killed. The Prophet ﷺ gave his ransom afterwards. Right? He used to be one of the greatest young men that the Prophet ﷺ loved so much, very knowledgeable. Very, very, very knowledgeable. The Prophet ﷺ used to entrust him with his secret. The secret of the Prophet used to be with Ibn Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He used to be known by narrating the ahadith of the eschatology. The ahadith of eschatology, or the ahadith of the akhirah, the ahadith of the fitan. He lived for a long time. The Prophet ﷺ made him a brother with Sidna Ammar ibn Yasir. Right? When he came to Medina, his brother was Sidna Ammar ibn Yasir radiallahu ta'ala. We can say more and more about Sidna Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman radiallahu ta'ala anhu in al-Khandaq, when the Sahaba were so, scared and so tired and so exhausted, and the rain and the wind and all of that. And the Prophet ﷺ told them, "Who wants to go to the camp and to the camp of the unbelievers and check what's their plans? And I guarantee him that he's going to come back safe, and I guarantee him that he's going to be with me in Jannah." And nobody, like, look at the incentive. He's gonna come safe, no doubt. Just go, and I guarantee you're going to come safe. The Prophet is guaranteeing your safety, and also the Prophet is guaranteeing your spot with him in Jannah. And nobody would stand up because they were all scared and they were all hungry and they were all cold and they were all in a state, see the humanity of the Sahaba. This is the humanity of the Sahaba, right? Right? So we should look at them in this humanity to benefit from them. And the first time, and the second time, and the third time the Prophet is calling and nobody. And then at the end he said, "Hudhayfah, stand up and go." And he said, oh my goodness, like, what am I going? He said, like, I wish I would have the earth open and swallowed me before that. But then he gathered his courage and he went and he brought the news to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wrapped him when he came back. He was cold and he wrapped him in his burda. And he slept close to him. And the Prophet went to pray and came back and he was still asleep. And he said, wake up, you, ya, ruqadu, okay, the Ruqan bi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like, you sleepy eye or whatever. Wake up, it's time to pray. And how, this is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with the Sahaba in a very natural way, right? In a very natural way, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what did he say?
Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam took hold of the calf of my legs or his leg.
Took the calf of the leg of the Prophet or his leg. He took the calf of my leg or the leg or his leg, right? He forgot, and then?
And he said, this is the position of the loincloth.
This is what it's supposed to be here, right in here.
And if you object, then somewhat lower down. But if you object, the loincloth has no right to the ankles.
You have no right to the ankles. Now people pay attention to that, but they forget the other signs of pride. They forget the other signs. They could find people being so, they elevate themselves over people because, oh, mashallah, I observe the sunnah. Look at these people, don't observe the sunnah, look at them. And here, following the sunnah becomes a musibah on the heart of the people because they feel that they are better than others. They feel that they are so better than others and they're so proud of that. So ask Allah Ta'ala to eradicate all the visible sign of pride from our hearts and from our visible appearances. And make us among those who follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and elevate us among those who live the life of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and model our life according to the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and follow him and love him and devote ourselves to his sunnah and to his service of his ummah. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Tomorrow, inshallah, we're going to have our class. And after tomorrow and so until we finish the book, inshallah. So we're going on a good rate, alhamdulillah. We're doing more than 50 hadith every session. So there are